الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهلون الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا واللانة الدائمة الباقية لأعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم إن الله اصطفى آدم ونوحا وعلى إبراهيم وعلى عمران على العالمين صلوات Alhamdulillah, with the blessings of the Azaf, Sayyid al-Shuhada. This is the sixth gathering that we are having, where we are seeking this opportunity to educate ourselves more about our values, values of the religion for which Imam Hussain alayhi salam sacrificed everything. It's an amanat which is in our hands. The amanat of the Shuhada of Karbala. And so we have to preserve it. We have to live by it. Not just learn it, but live by that amanat which Hussein and his family and companions have given to us. And this azah becomes a way of renewing our bayat and commitment to that religion in the name of Hussein ibn Ali and his awlad and his ashab. Salawat. Everything else, if you look at the traditions that we have, many times, you know, since we do not know how the traditions or the gatherings, the way they are done in the Shi'i community, how they have gradually evolved. You look at the calendar, we have the Viladat for Rasulullah, we have the Majlis for the Wafat of Rasul. We have the Viladat for Amir al-Mu'mineen, Majlis for the Shahadat of Amir al-Mu'mineen. We have the Viladat, you know, a celebration for Bibi Fatima. We have the Majlis for the Wafat of the Bibi. Sometimes we think because we look at the hierarchy of the Masumeen, the Prophet was first, then Ali, and then Fatima, and then the Imams, one after another. We think this is how we have been doing things from day one. You had to realize that the first Majlis and gathering which happened was in the name of Imam Hussein. It was the Azaw Sayyid al-Shuhada which established the system. People used to gather to remember Karbala first, and as the barakat of that gathering, gradually they said, okay, let's have the Majlis for the Wafat of Rasulullah. Let us remember Shahadat of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Let us remember the day of Wafat of Bibi Fatima. All other things that we do are actually barakat of the Azah and the Majlis of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. So appreciate this institution that we have, which has been given to us by our Imam. And, you know, that's where we learn quite a lot, because when we come to this majalis, we are on an emotional level, you know, prepared to accept the message which is being given. The theme that I have selected for these majalis has to do with the issue of family life in Islam, from the perspective of the Qur'an and the Ahlul Bayt. I have that commitment, and I'm staying with it, and I'm trying my best, you know, to be with the Qur'an and the Ahlul Bayt. about these issues which actually, you know, the community at large faces. If we don't talk about it now, when will we talk about it? But we are combining. History is there, fadail are there, the seerah of Ahlul Bayt is there, because that is the whole purpose of the azah of Sayyidul Shuhada. Salawat pranayik para. Our discussion started with this concept of peace in life. Peace and tranquility, based on three dimensions that Quran talks about: zaman, makan, and makin. Time, space, and spouse. We talked about makan, the family, the system of family life in Islam, with a preference for what I would call semi-attached family system. But the emphasis in there is for silatul rahim. We talked about different issues after that, all connected to that. Then we came to this issue of, you know, peace and tranquility through makin, the spouse. The ayat of Quran from Surah Ar-Rum, ayat number 21, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, from his signs, wa min ayatihi, that he created spouses for you from your own species. And why did he do that? لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا, so that you may gain sukoon and peace and tranquility through that relationship. And then he says, he doesn't just leave it just like that. He says, I have given you the initial ingredients to maintain that sukoon. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنُكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. The elements of love and the element of compassion is there. Muhabbat, Mawaddat, Rahmat, Sabr. We talked about the issue of Mawaddat and Rahmat as far as the husbands are concerned in the last two majalis, emphasizing the point that when we talk about the element of Rahmat, Rahmat cannot be separated from the virtue of Sabr and patience, forbearance, willingness to forgive. And I would like to continue that theme today, focusing more on the female side as far as the wives are concerned. Salawat pranayik para. The examples I gave were from Surah Al-Tahrim, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started with the examples of the prophets. Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, Prophet Lut alayhi salam, and our own prophet. As good husbands who had challenges with wives who were not that good. I will have to be polite here. We are talking about, you know, prophets' wives. After all, they were azwaj of the Anbiya. And the challenges they had were more difficult than what we see in our own personal life. But we see that they exercise the element of rahmah, patience and forbearance. In the case of our prophet, he maintained his, you know, element of being rahmatan lil alameen. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who comes down with a warning from his side on behalf of Rasulullah. Tonight we'll go to the other example from Surah Tahrim. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about a good wife, a mu'mina wife who had an evil husband. And so this is where we say, you know, Quran, when you especially, if you look at Surah Al-Tahrim, this is actually a surah of family life. It talks about the difficulties and challenges that people can have in their family life. And this is a very interesting story. We'll talk about it later on. But in all those, you will see that the element of rahmah comes in. Patience and forbearance in dealing with issues and not immediately thinking about the issue of talaq and divorce. That is there in Islam, but it is the last resort. Things have to be done before on the basis of mawadda and rahmah to prevent reaching to that final solution. Salawat pranayik para. Tonight, just two things. As far as challenges in marriage is concerned. And that is actually to do with the issue of, you know, and you cannot have a life without challenges. Otherwise, it will be a very boring life. You just have to make sure you are able to manage it. That is the whole key to success and happiness in this life. If you have a life without difficulties and challenges, it will be really boring. And this is where we have to know that, okay, we came to this dunya for ibtila and imtihan. An imtihan doesn't just happen by faqr and poverty and illness. It also happens by the interaction that we have with one another. Parents are tested through their children. Children are tested through their parents. A brother is tested through the attitude of the other brother. A sister is being tested by the attitude of the other sister. You know, even these interactions that we have with one another, these are all, you know, elements, grounds of test and trial that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting us through. He wants to see how we react in that given situation. Are we fulfilling our duty or not? And so even in marriage life, you know, you will not be without challenges. But the issue is, are you able to manage it according to the Islamic way or not? Because as you know, we have this saying in Urdu, jahan bartan honge wahan awaz bhi hogi. When you put the pots together, whether in dishwasher or in the sink, you know, you're going to have noise there. So if you bring two people from two different families, two different backgrounds, different likes and dislikes, they cannot become automatically one, melt into one, no. They can get closer, but there will be tension sometimes. And this is where you have to learn how to deal with that, you know, moments of challenge and the tensions. The first issue that I would like to talk tonight is the issue of privacy. The issue of respecting, you know, the privacy of one another. In this dunya, among adults, there is no one closer to the other than a husband to the wife and wife to the husband. Even adult children and parents are not that close compared to the relationship between husband and wife. And they know about one another inside out. You know, one of the reasons why you see the success of the mission of Rasulullah, you know, you have to realize the first person who accepted his message was his own wife. She knew him inside out. He's not a person who is a public figure one way and private life something else. Nobody knew Rasulullah better than Khadija. And when she becomes the first one to accept the message, that actually is a certificate for the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so you have to give, you know, respect to that relationship between husband and wife. That they are so close to one another, unlike any two other people in this world. And Quran in Surah Baqarah, ayat number 183, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used this, such a beautiful, you know, expression for this relationship. Where he says, Hunna libasun lakum wa antum libasun lahunna. He says the wives are libas for their husbands, and the husbands are libas for their wives. Look at the hikmat of Quran. You don't have to go to the school of psychology to understand these issues. Quran doesn't use any scientific terminology, psychological terminology. It's very simple words which convey the concept so easily that whether you are a PhD or somebody who lives in the desert of Arabia, both will understand it fully and completely. And this is the beauty. You know, we many times about issues we say, okay, let's go and see what modern psychology has to say about it. Oh, you have everything in the Quran and the seerah of the Ahlul Bayt. Go back to it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says a wife is a libas for the husband, and the husband is a libas for the wife. A very simple statement. What is the function of libas? Libas means garment or dress, the clothing. What is the function of the libas? Number one, it is used to protect ourselves from extreme weathers. So protection is the first function of libas. The second function of libas is it adorns us in the society. We don't just go out just like that. You know, we make ourselves more presentable to the society. And, you know, major part of it deals with how we dress. And so the second function of libas is adornment for us. It's a zenith. And the third is that it actually is a satir. It conceals the physical defects that we have in our body. That's the function of libas. One, protection from extreme weathers. Number two, it makes us presentable in the society, adornment. And number three, it conceals. It is satir for our inner defects in the body. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, a wife is a libas for the husband, and a husband is a libas for the wife. What does it mean? All these three elements for the purpose of libas is there. They are there to protect one another during the extreme situations of life. They, as a couple, become more respectable in the society. They adorn one another. Even their ibadat becomes, you know, multiple times more sawab than they were singles. And the third element, which is the most important one, that they conceal the weaknesses that they have. They know the weaknesses of one another, but they become like a satir against the rest of the world. They protect the honor and dignity of one another. Nobody is perfect. Nobody is masoom, other than those who have been made masoom by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as husband and wife, they are so close, they know. They know the positive elements, they know the good sides of the person, they know the negative sides of the weaknesses of the person, like no one else. But they are libas for one another. They might be open to one another, they know one another completely, but when it comes to the rest of the society, they become like libas. They conceal the weaknesses of one another. And this is where we have to realize this whole concept of not exposing the weakness of the wife to the others in the family, or of the husband to others in the family. Salawat upon Nabi Para. We have to learn from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a hadith from the Ma'sumeen where they say that tukhalliqu bi akhlaqillah. Acquire the akhlaq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We used the example of rahmat yesterday. And one of the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is He is sattarul uyub. He conceals the defects of the people. You know, if you look at the dua Arafah of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, that we recited on the 9th of Zulhijjah, that Imam Hussain alayhi salam recited in Arafat, that's such a powerful dua. If you go through the translation of it, the way we talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that, oh Allah, you know so much about me. If you wanted to expose me, I would have no respect and dignity even in the eyes of my parents. But you have concealed. You know, but still you have concealed it. And that is the element of rububiyyat. He is Sattarul Uyub. He covers the Uyub and the defects of the people. And when we talk about this concept of husband and wife as libas for one another, We have to become sattarul uyub for one another. Yes, when there are issues, they have to be discussed. We have to do amr bil ma'ruf and nahi anil munkar to help one another to become better, you know, mu'mineen and better shias and better human beings. But this has not to be, you know, exposed to those who are outside, especially the in-laws. Do not put down the respect of your husband or wife in the eyes of the rest of the members of the family. Salawat upon Akbar. There is a concept in the ahadith of our a'imma where they say that be careful of the ni'mat, because every ni'mat has a negative element to it. When you get a ni'mat, use it in a positive way and avoid the negative part of it. The means of communication that we have, so fast, for so easy, so cheap these days, these are ni'mat for us. But there's also bala attached to that ni'mat. You know, when we look at this issue, whether it's telephone, email, MSN, texting, and this and that, as soon as the problem starts, immediately the phone goes. And once the issue goes out of the control of that libas, the circle of libas, sometimes it cannot be resolved that easily. There was a time when we didn't have these means of communication. Maybe there was a problem between husband and wife, and the wife became very, you know, upset or angry or whatever happened. You know, she might take a few days to think about it, and maybe she might write a letter, put a stamp on it, and put it in the mailbox. Maybe after 2 or 3 weeks it will reach to the parents. By the time it reaches there, this problem is gone. Although the parents are left with the anxiety. But now the problem starts and the telephone call goes. Immediately. And this is where we are saying, you know, make it the issue of libas. Consider one another to be the libas for one another. And this is where I'm saying, not that, you know, you don't talk about it. If there is an issue, it has to be resolved. Sit down calmly, find a solution for it. And if it's not a matter of violence, can keep it confined to yourselves and deal with it within that circle of that libas. Of course, if it cannot be resolved and it creates more problem, then you need outsiders' help. Or if it's a matter of violence, yes, then others have to be involved. We cannot deny that. But the issue is that look at that perspective of marriage, the relationship between husband and wife is hunna libasun lakum wa antum libasun lahunna. Salawat upon Nabi Barak. The second issue, as far as the, you know, women are concerned, well, we talked about the husband's perspective last night or the night before, that they would like to domain, to, you know, control their own domain. They are the sarparast and the head of the family. And yes, you can be. You have your, you know, option of being a dictator or a benevolent leader. Sometimes a simple thank you can work wonders. Even the wife on the other side, she doesn't want to dominate the house, she wants to dominate the heart of the husband. And there is no problem in that. It's a very natural desire, and it's a good desire, it should be there. If there is not there, then there's a problem. But many times, you see, we see they go around trying to do that in a wrong way. When things don't work, one of the first you know, ideas that come to mind is, oh, somebody has done a nazar or a jadu. You know, black magic. And this is where we have to realize that interpersonal relationships, these are serious issues. If there is a problem, you have to look at the problem. If you don't look at the problem, you will not be able to get the solution. But unfortunately, you know, the first route is to blame outside forces. Somebody has done something. And immediately, you know, the call goes to a amil sahib or a muallim sahib. And mashallah, in our ethnic newspapers, there are so many commercials there. People who actually exploit the weaknesses of individuals. They made a business out of this. People look for amal, they look for ta'weez. And I know I'm making them angry here, but this is the reality. Although we have moved away from that part of the world to this part of the world, everything we do in a very modern style, in an educated manner, but when it comes to these issues, we are total desi. You know, back to the roots. And first thing, you know, oh, you're sitting there in Canada, you call somebody in India or Pakistan, explain your problem, and he says, yes, I know. I know the person who has done the jadu on you. Baba, they have ilm al-ghaib there? Just think about it. Because Allah has given them that power that they have ilm al-ghaib sitting there somewhere in India and Pakistan, they're able to tell you that somebody has done whom you don't know, you just doubt. And that this is what you have to do. This is actually running away from the problem. And if you run away from the problem, you will not be able to find the solution. And this is where we had realized, you know, when we talk about family issues, that's not the solution. You know, you have to look at is the issue of akhlaq. It is the attitude, the behavior, the interaction with one another, which would be the problem. Look at the circumstances, what happened. And try to look at the reality and then find a solution. Maybe these faults are on both sides. Both need to work on it. Or if it's one side, they have to accept it. And that is where the solution would be there. And that is where you will be able to regain the sukoon and peace and tranquility in life. Salawat wa rahmatullah. Akhlaq is the solution, not this ta'weez and, you know, all these things that we hear about. Especially since we're talking about the wife here. Even the attitude, the body language, the tone of the speech, everything has an impact. The facial expression. And the husbands are able to pick that very quick. They get the message. And so even the facial expression of the wife, you know, is important. And they make sure that the message is coming out clear and a positive one. When it comes to the issue of, you know, amal and partnership in life, yes, it is not a duty on a wife to do anything inside the home. But one of the expressions of their muhabbat is to be a partner in the difficulties and challenges of life, demands of life, which is actually working inside the home. And the most important thing is this, the tongue, the speech. Most of these problems, whether on domestic level, national level, international level, can be traced back to what they said and what we said. If you look at the, you know, we have a hadith where one of our imams, very beautiful, those, you know, these words can only come from the Ahlul Bayt. And the beauty of the language of Arabic, where they say, you know, look at this tongue. Jirmuhu sagir, jirmuhu kabir. It's the same word, jim, re, mim. One is with dhamma, pesh, and the other is with kasra. Jirmuhu saghir. The mass of this tongue is small. Wa jirmuhu kabir. But the crime or the sin of this is great. And this is where we have to realize, we have to be very careful what we are saying. You know, it's not the issue of what you are saying. It is how you are saying it which becomes a problem. You know, many times you sit in the car. Well, many places now it's a law that you can't smoke even inside the car. But when there were no laws about smoking or non-smoking inside the car, many people would actually put a sign. You know, one way of saying is no smoking. Another is don't smoke. And the third sign would say thank you for not smoking. All three signs are saying the same thing. But the last one says thank you for not smoking. Is the same objective but achieved in a more polite manner. And this is where I think, you know, the sisters as wives have to think about it. Don't use that expression, no smoking. You know, even if you use that same language of thank you after the coffee, things can work. And this is where we have to be careful about it, because if you look at the ayat of Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Taha, when Prophet Musa alayhi salam and Prophet Harun alayhi salam were assigned the task of going and confronting whom? Fir'aun. Not even an ordinary person. Look at the instruction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has giving to Musa and Harun, and he says, idhaba, all both of you, go, idhaba ila Fir'aun innahu tagha. Both of you go to Fir'aun because he has rebelled against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What kind of a rebellion was there? He was claiming to be a Rabb against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Ana Rabbukum al-Ala, I am your great Lord, you have to worship me. With that kind of guna, on that level, he is known as somebody who has done tughyan. He has rebelled against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even in that case of Fir'aun, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say to Musa and Harun? فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. O Musa and Harun, when you go to Fir'aun, speak to him قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا, in a polite and lenient manner. We are not even talking about, you know, a simple crime. We are talking about shirk here, or kufr. And even to Fir'aun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to Musa and Harun, say qawlan layyana, be polite and lenient in what you are saying to him, la'allahu yatazakkar aw yakhsha, maybe he will remember the reality and accept your message. Or he might fear the azab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and repent. And so a person like Fir'aun, even when you want to advise him, Allah is saying to Musa and Harun, فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. What about our mu'mina mu'mina? They deserve more respect than Fir'aun. You know, if they've done something, you know, be polite with them in the way you talk to him. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, when it comes to this issue of zaban, this is the biggest of blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ability to speak, the ability to communicate with one another. That is the identity of a human being as opposed to animals. But this same ni'mat can become a cause of serious bala and fitna within the family. And so we have to restrain and control our tongue, not on what you are saying, but how you are saying it. Salawat on the Ikbarah. Let me just digress slightly. When it comes to Musa alayhi salam and Ulul Azm prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders him that O Musa and Harun, قُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. When you go to Fir'aun, say قَوْلَ لَيِّن. When it comes to our Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ali Imran, ayat number 159, doesn't order him or instruct him to be polite in his speech. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises our Prophet by saying, فَبِرَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. It's not an issue of قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. O Musa and Harun, be polite and lenient in your speech. To our Rasul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that because of the rahmat from us, you in your entire existence and wujud have become lenient for your ummah. It's not only his qawl and his speech. The entire wujud, the sacred existence of Rasulullah has become lintalahum. You have become polite and lenient for the people. Salawat pranay kbara. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيزَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَزُّ مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. Oh Muhammad, if you were a harsh person, people would have dispersed away from you. فَعْفُ عَنُهُمْ. Therefore, pardon them. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ. And ask forgiveness for them. وَشَاوِرُهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. And in serious matters, you can seek the consultation of your companions. فَإِذَا عَظَمْتَ. Of course, when you make the final decision, it's your decision. فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Then do tawakkul on Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَوَكِّلِينَ. Salawat upon the Ikbar. So our Rasul, you know, his own existence is actually layyin. He is so lenient with the way he deals with the people. And that is what we have to keep in mind when we deal with one another. Salawat upon the Ikbar. Look at the example of Bibi Khadija. The Prophet, when he started the mission of Islam, early days, there was so strong opposition. They ridiculed him, they labeled him. First they said he's Majnoon, then they said he's Sha'ir, then they said he's a Sahir. You know, this whole business of labeling Muslims fanatics and terrorists and this and that, this is nothing new. It started from day one against our Prophet. And so, first they ridiculed him, then they imposed social economic boycott against him. Again, same thing we see happening against Muslim countries. But then, the most important thing, you know, Rasulullah, of course, he's Rasul, he's Masoom. But he has sent in a human form. The emotions are there. Just think about it. He goes out every day, calls people towards Islam. قُولُ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ تُفْلِهُ. Say لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. You will gain salvation. No response. Rather, they are ridiculing him, joking about him, you know, putting labels on him. But at the end of the day, he knows, when I go home, I have a wife who believes me fully. That was the morale, you know, that the Prophet was able to keep it up always, even in that difficult and depressing situation, because of the loyalty and support of Bibi Khadija salawatullah alayha. Salawat. That is where, you know, he has all these problems and opposition outside, but when he comes home, because of the akhlaq and the support of his wife, he has sukoon and peace and tranquility within the home. And that is where we have to keep in mind. And the impact of the akhlaq of Bibi Khadija had a lasting, you know, influence in the heart and the mind of Rasulullah. Yes, he married many women after her. Rather, as one of the famous orators in India used to say, Rasulullah married only one, all others married Rasulullah. If you would go and ask him, you know, who was your wife? Who was in your mind and heart? Even after years after the wafat of Bibi Khadija, the response would be Khadija. I'll just narrate to you one example where one day in Medina, Hala, the sister of Khadija, came to visit Rasulullah. Outside the door, she asked for permission. Can I come in? The voice of Hala was very similar to her sister Khadija. Rasulullah heard her voice and welcomed her and started remembering Khadija. He praised Khadija in such a way that according to, and this is a narration from Sahih Bukhari, that Hazrat Aisha became very jealous. And this is her narration. فَغِيرُتُ I became jealous, فَقُلْتُ And I said to Rasul, مَا تَسْكُرُ مِنْ عُجُوزٍ مِنْ عَجَائِزِ قُرَيْشِ حُمَرَاءُ الشِّدْقَيْنِ حَلَكَتْ فِي الدَّحَرِ وَقَدْ أَبْدَلَكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا مِنْهَا For how long are you going to remember this old lady from the old ladies of Quraysh? Who was toothless, so old, and she had died long time ago. Whereas Allah has replaced for you a better one, khayran minha. She was referring to herself, of course. Now Bukhari quotes this, but then avoids the response of Rasulullah. This is his habit. And because of that, some of the commentators of Bukhari under this hadith, they say, you know, Rasul's silence is approval of the statement made by Aisha. But if you go to other sources, including Ahmad bin Hanbal, Imam Tirmizi, and Ibn Kathir, the historian, they will actually give you the full narration where Aisha herself, she says, when I uttered these words, فَتَغَيَّرَ وَجْهُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ The face, the expression of the face of Rasulullah changed. تَغَيُّرًا لَمْ أَرُهُ تَغَيُّرَ عِنْدَ شَيْءٍ قَطُّ إِلَّا عِنْدَ نُزُولِ الْوَحِي He says, I saw the seriousness on his face and it wouldn't change. Except when wahi was coming on him, we would know that he's not normal at the moment. And that was the way Rasulullah's you know, emotions came out on his face. And then he says, and this is her narration continuing, كَيْفَ قُلْتِ You know, how could you say this? وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ آمَنَتْ بِي إِذْ كَذَّبَنِ النَّاسِ How can you say this about Khadija? By Allah, she believed in me at the time the whole world was against me. وَعَاوَتْنِ إِذْ رَفَضَنِ النَّاثِ She sheltered me while people have forsaken me. وَرُزِقْتُ مِنْهَا الْوَلَدِ وَحُرِّمْتُمُوهُ مِنِّي And Allah only gave me children through her and not through you all. Salawat pardon the Akbar. رَاحَ عَلَيَّ بِهَا شَهْرًا According to her narration, Rasulullah basically became so displeased that he actually kept away from her for a week, for a month. The point here is that this is the testimony to the akhlaq of Bibi Khadija from the youngest of the wives of Rasulullah. And this is where you understand the greatness of Bibi Khadija. And that was because of her akhlaq. We as Shia of Ali, Our sisters, in their family life, they have to look at that example of Khadija, salawatullah alayha, as the example of the akhlaq, loyalty, and support that she provided for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salawatullah. As long as Rasulullah had Khadija and Abu Talib, as his supporters. The Quraysh did not dare physically harm him. They did everything. It's only when both of them passed away within a few months of one another that the Quraysh conspired to assassinate and kill Rasulullah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then orders him to do hijrat and leave Makkah and go towards Medina. And so that is the impact of the akhlaq and the sacrifice of Khadija as the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salawat alaykum. Let me go to Surah Tahrim again and present to you the example of a couple, because Surah Tahrim, we saw the example of the husbands who were good and anbiya and who had challenges with their wives and their attitudes and behavior. The opposite of that is also in Quran, in the same surah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, mentions, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِمْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ. And Allah gives the example of the believing women, the example of the wife of Fir'aun, Asiya. So you have a believing and a good woman and an evil husband. And look at the sabr there. We saw the sabr on the other side. Prophet Lut, Prophet Nuh, and our Rasul. Now we have the opposite of that. Where you have a husband like Fir'aun and a wife like Asiya. Of course, she was in the same deen and mazhab as Fir'aun before. But when Musa alayhi salam came with the mu'jiza, she basically accepted that truth. At the expense of what? Think about it. She was not just an ordinary woman. She was wife of the emperor who actually was thinking about himself as Ana Rabbukum al-A'la, I am your great lord. Your life and death depends on me. It's not only, you know, the palace. Everything that you can think of as far as the good things of this dunya, the material life, was at her fingertips. You're talking about status or palace, you're talking about money and wealth, you're talking about jewelry and other things, luxuries of this dunya. Everything was that at her disposal. And she was given this imtihan, that Musa is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He brought the mu'jiza. If you believe in him, you will lose everything. But she decided to leave this dunya for the sake of what is haq and the akhirah. Fir'aun didn't like it. First tried to explain, you know, talk to her out of this. She refused. Then he started threatening her. She still refused. Eventually, he implemented the threat. And he ordered his own wife, Asiya bint Muzahim, to be crucified. She's put on the cross. And that is where we see that, you know, she prayed. And this dua, the words are there in Surah Tahrim, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives her example. Where she prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah had, you know, left everything for the sake of your religion. قَالَتْ رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَاللَّهِ make a house for me in Jannah. وَنَجِّنِ مِنْ فِرْعَوْنِ وَعَمَلِهِ and rescue me from Fir'aun and his misdeeds. وَنَجِّنِ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ and rescue me from the unjust people. And that is where we see, you know, her dua is mentioned in Surah Tahrim. But the riwayat that we have in the tafsir of that ayat, we are told that at that time, Jibreel comes down. The hijab and the veils are lifted from her eyes while she's still alive on the cross. And Jibreel made her see the palace that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had reserved for Asiya in Jannah. She becomes a shahida on the cross but a Shahida with a smile on her face because she could see the ultimate destination that she had. Salawat Pranay Ekbar. And so Quran gives us real examples. You know, challenging wives, challenging husbands. And this is where the element of mawadda and rahmah has to be exercised. I don't think our sisters have husbands like Fir'aun. And I don't think our brothers have wives like wives of Prophet Lut and Prophet Nuh. Allah mentioned about Rasulullah. You know, our challenges cannot be more difficult than theirs. And so this is where the element of mawadda and rahmah has to come in, and the seerah of Ahlul Bayt has to be kept when we live our life as the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. Salawat alaykum. The example of Amir al-Mu'minin Ali and Bibi Fatima for us is the Uswa Hasana. Just as we talked about Rasulullah and Bibi Khadija, you see the exact mirror image in form of Amir al-Mu'minin and Fatima al-Zahra. You know, if you look at the support that Amir al-Mu'minin felt because of the presence of Bibi Fatima on his side, it is a very strong element for this, you know, boosting the morale of Ali. And I'm being very careful in choosing these words. Fatima was the pillar of support for Ali. Whatever she did, after the wafat of Rasulullah, everything that she did was for the sake of Ali, including demanding fadak. She didn't have this love for this dunya and the luxury of this dunya. She wasn't asking fadak for the material value. If you really want to know why she was asking fadak, you should go and look at the commentary of Nahl al-Balagha by Ibn Abil Hadid al-Mu'tazili, a Sunni scholar, was written a very extensive commentary on Nahl al-Balagha, 20 volumes. And under the commentary of the letter of Amir al-Mu'mineen to Osman ibn Hunayf, his governor in Basra, where Amir al-Mu'mineen mentions Fadak in a passing manner, Ibn Abil Hadid al-Mu'tazili, a Sunni commentator, has a very extensive discussion about Fadak, its history and what happened and, you know, how it happened. And there he says, one day in my madrasa in Baghdad, I asked my teacher about this whole issue of Fadak. And I asked him, did the Khalifa knew or believe that Fatima was true in her claim for Fadak? And the teacher smiled and he said, yes, he knew that Fatima was true in her claim. So he says, then I asked the teacher, why didn't he just give Fadak to Fatima at that time? And that is where the teacher smiles. He says, you don't know the reality of this dunya. If the Khalifa had given Fadak to Fatima just on the basis of her claim, believing her to be truthful and knowing that she is truthful, he knew that the second demand of Fatima would be that Khilafat is the right of my husband Ali. The demand for Fadak was not for the sake of Fadak itself. The demand by Fatima for Fadak was as a stepping stone for the haqq of Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. And so this is where you have to realize, whether Fatima speaks or she is silent, whether she is pleased or, you know, unhappy, ہر حال میں فاطمہ نے جو کچھ کیا ہے علی کے خاطر کیا ہے. اور یہ مثالیں ہمارے سامنے رہنی چاہیے. ہمارے عملی زندگی کے لیے یہی ہمارے لیے اسوہ اور نمونہ ہیں. قرآن صرف تھیوری ہے, اور اس کا پریکٹیکل اگزامپل دیکھنا ہو تو آل محمد ہے ہمارے لیے. جو کچھ فاطمہ نے کیا ہے علی کے خاطر کیا ہے. جس طرح سے رسول اللہ کی زندگی میں ہم دیکھتے ہیں کہ جب تک ابو طالب اور خدیجہ زندہ رہے قریش نے ان پر حملہ نہیں کیا جسمانی طور پہ. علی کی زندگی میں بھی دو حمایتی ستون تھے, ایک رسول اور ایک فاطمہ. جب تک ان دونوں میں سے ایک بھی رہے, آپ سنیوں کی تاریخ میں بھی دیکھ لیں بات جو ہوتی ہے بیعت کی, یہ کہتے ہیں فاطمہ کی وفات کے بعد بیعت کی, وہ بھی خیر اس میں ڈسکشن ہے, لیکن کم سے کم جب تک فاطمہ موجود تھیں علی کے ساتھ جرات نہیں تھی کہ علی سے کوئی ڈیمانڈ کیا جائے. اور اسی سے اندازہ ہوتا ہے کہ چونکہ مقصد حیات ایک تھا دونوں کا, اور جو مودت و رحمت کا جذبہ تھا ہر لحاظ سے, سوچنے کا انداز بھی ایک ہے, مقصد حیات بھی ایک ہے, قربانیاں بھی ایک ہیں, خوشیوں میں بھی ساتھ ہیں, مصائب میں بھی ساتھ ہیں. بلکہ امیر المومنین ان زمانے کے حالات پر تبصرہ کرتے ہوئے فرماتے ہیں لقد كنت انظر الیہا فتکشف عنی الہموم والاحزان, کہ جب ہم گھر پہ آتے تھے واپس اور جب فاطمہ کے چہرے پر نظر جاتی تھی تو ہمارے جتنے ہم اور غم تھے سب کے سب ختم ہو جاتے تھے. یہ جذبہ ہونا چاہیے, یہ محبت ہونی چاہیے, اور یہ اسی وقت ہوگی کہ جب ہمارا مقصد حیات ایک ہی ہو. عجیب و غریب بات ہے کہ جب علی اور فاطمہ کی زندگی, خصوصاً وہ آخری دور ہے رسول کی وفات کے بعد, پوری دنیا کا مشکل کشا علی ہے لیکن علی کے مشکل کشا فاطمہ ہے. علی دنیا کے تمام مصائب کو جھیلتے ہیں لیکن جب گھر پہ آتے ہیں فاطمہ کے چہرے منور پر نظر جاتی ہے جتنا حزن اور غم اور ہم ہے سب ختم. اور اسی کو اگر آپ دیکھیں یہ ان کی نسل میں بھی وہی سلسلہ چلا ہے کہ پورا خاندان جب مصیبت کے وقت کی بات ہوتی ہے, دین اسلام کا معاملہ ہوتا ہے, پورا خاندان متحد ہو جاتا ہے. جناب آسیہ کے سلسلے میں جو ہم نے روایت پیش کی ہے اسی کو ہم ملانا چاہیں گے واقعات کربلا سے, کہ جناب آسیہ کو شہادت سے پہلے خداوند عالم نے ان کے چہرے کے حجابات کو اٹھا دیے, اور جو منزل خداوند عالم نے ان کے لیے مقرر کی تھی جنت میں وہ انہوں نے اپنے نظروں سے دیکھا ہے. اور اس لیے شہادت کے وقت چہرے پر مسکراہٹ تھی. اگر اس روایت کو آپ سمجھ سکیں تو پھر شب عاشور کی وہ روایت کو سمجھنا مشکل نہیں ہوگا کہ جہاں امام حسین علیہ السلام نے اپنے اصحاب کو جمع کیا, وفاداری کا امتحان لیا اور سب کے سب وہاں کامیاب نکلے. چراغ کو گل ضرور کر دیا تھا لیکن اس وقت کسی نے حسین کو چھوڑا نہیں ہے. اور جب وفاداری کا اعلان ہو گیا بنو ہاشم کی طرف سے اور اصحاب حسینی کی طرف سے, اس وقت امام حسین علیہ السلام نے معجزے سے اپنے دو انگلیوں کی طرف اشارہ کیا اور ان شہداء کو ان کے جو منازل جنت کے ہیں وہ دکھائیں. ان اصحاب کے عزم اور یقین میں کوئی فرق نہیں آیا لیکن ان کا جو عقیدہ صرف علم الیقین کی بنیاد پر تھا اس معجزوں کو دیکھنے کے بعد عین الیقین کی شکل میں بدل جاتا ہے. انہوں نے اب جنت کے ان مناظر کو دیکھا جس طرح سے آسیہ نے دیکھا تھا سولی کے اوپر, اور اسی سوال جواب اور گفتگو کے بعد کا وہ قصہ ہے کہ امام نے جب کہا کہ تم سب کے سب شہید ہو جاؤ گے تو ایک نوجوان کھڑا ہوتا ہے بنو ہاشم کا وہ کہتا ہے کہ اے چچا کیا میرا نام بھی اس فہرست میں ہے اس لیے کہ اس کو شاید احساس ہوا کہ یہ صرف بڑوں کی بات ہو رہی ہے ہمارا تو شمار بڑوں میں نہیں ہوتا ہے 14 سال کا سن ہے امام حسین علیہ السلام نے قاسم کو دیکھا اور دیکھنے کے بعد بھائی کی محبت یاد آ جاتی ہے قاسم کی کمسنی کو دیکھا اس کے سوال کو دیکھا مولا نے سوال کیا کہ یہ بتاؤ یا بنیا کیف الموت عندک بیٹا تمہیں احساس بھی ہے کس بات کی بات ہو رہی ہے مرنے کی بات ہو رہی ہے تمہارے ذہن میں مرنے کا تصور بھی ہے اس سن و سال کو دیکھیں اور جواب کو دیکھیں قرآن اور اہل بیت کے کلام میں مماثلت نظر آتی ہے وہاں خداوند عالم نے سمپل لباس کا لفظ استعمال کیا ہے اور یہ 14 سال کا بچہ آل محمد کا بھی بہت ہی سادگی سے جواب دیتا ہے کہ چچا جان احلا من العسل میری نظر میں یہ موت جو اللہ کے خاطر ہوگی یہ شہد سے بھی زیادہ شیرین ہے حسین نے قاسم کو اپنے گلے سے لگایا اور کہا بیٹا تمہارا نام بھی شہدا کی فہرست میں ہے یقیناً یہ رات وہ رات تھی کہ جہاں بنو ہاشم کی خواتین نے بھی اپنے بچوں کو تلقین کی ہے کہ دیکھو کل شہادت و قربانی کا مرحلہ ہے ایک بات کو ذہن میں ہمیشہ رکھیں کہ یہ نوجوان شہدائے کربلا کامیابی ان کی تھی لیکن ان کے کامیابی کے پیچھے ان کی ماں کا کردار ہے یہ جناب ام فروہ کی تربیت کا اثر تھا کہ قاسم اس قسم کا جواب دے سکے وہاں عاشور کے دن جب شہادت کا مرحلہ آتا ہے اصحاب کے بعد بنو ہاشم کے افراد جب جاتے ہیں قاسم جب سامنے گئے ہیں امام حسین علیہ السلام کے امام نے انکار کیا ہے اتنا انکار کرتے ہیں یہاں تک کہ روایت میں ہے کہ جناب قاسم امام کے قدموں میں پڑ جاتے ہیں بوسہ لیتے ہیں قدموں کا اور حسین روتے ہوئے اپنے گلے سے لگاتے ہیں اجازت دیتے ہیں لیکن اتنا روئے ہیں یبکیان حتی غشی علیہما دونوں ایک دوسرے سے گلے ملنے کے بعد اتنا روئے ہیں کہ دونوں پر غشی کا عالم طاری ہو گیا تھا عزداران حسین قاسم اپنے بابا کے شہادت کے وقت صرف 2 سال کے تھے قاسم کو بڑا کیا ہے حسین نے اپنے فرزند کی طرح یہ ایک بیٹا تھا جو اذن جہاد کے لیے آیا تھا اجازت دے دیتے ہیں لیکن حمید بن مسلم جو راوی اور رپورٹر تھا یزید لشکر کا اس کا بیان ہے کہ ہم نے دیکھا ایک نوجوان آ رہا تھا بنو ہاشم سے جو قمر کی طرح تھا چاند کی طرح اس کی صورت تھی اور اتنا کم سن تھا کہ اس کے پیر رکاب تک نہیں پہنچ رہے تھے اور جناب قاسم نے آ کے اپنا تعارف کیا ہے رجز کے ذریعے اور اس کے بعد حملہ شروع کرتے ہیں اس نوجوان نے وہ جہاد لڑی ہے کہ جہاں تقریباً 30 سے 35 یزیدیوں کو فنار کرتے ہیں لیکن آخر میں چاروں طرف سے حملہ شروع ہو جاتا ہے اس طرح سے شدت ہوتی ہے حملے میں کہ جناب قاسم اپنے کو گھوڑے پر نہ سنبھال سکے گھوڑے سے زمین پر آتے ہیں اور آواز دیتے ہیں یا اماں ادرکنی اے چچا جان میری مدد کو پہنچیے حسین اس شدت محبت کے خاطر اپنی تلوار کو
پتھر نکالتے ہیں اور یزیدی لشکر پر حملہ کر دیتے ہیں تاکہ قاسم تک پہنچ سکے لیکن یہ حملہ اتنا شدید تھا کہ یزیدی لشکر میں ہلچل مچ جاتی ہے گھوڑے مغرب سے مشرق اور مشرق کے گھوڑے مغرب کی طرف دوڑ جاتے ہیں عزداران حسین اسی ہلچل میں جناب قاسم کا جسم پامال ہو جاتا ہے امام حسین علیہ السلام جب قاسم کے پاس پہنچے زمین کربلا پر بیٹھ جاتے ہیں کہتے ہیں بیٹا بہت ہی تکلیف دے بات ہے انت تدعونی تو نے مجھے آواز دی لیکن ہم جواب نہ دے سکے اور جواب بھی دیا تو وہ جواب کوئی مفید ثابت نہ ہوا عزداران حسین قاسم کے لاشے کو حمید بن مسلم کی روایت ہے حسین نے قاسم کو اٹھایا قاسم کے سینے کو اپنے سینے سے لگایا اور خیمگاہ کی طرف بڑھے لیکن روایت اسی کی ملتی ہے کہ ہم نے دیکھا کہ قاسم کے قدم جو ہے زمین پر خط کھینچ رہے تھے اے حمید بن مسلم تو نے کہا تھا یہ اتنا نوجوان تھا کہ اس کے پیر رکاب تک نہیں پہنچ رہے تھے اب تو حسین کا سینہ اور قاسم کا سینہ لگا ہوا ہے لیکن قاسم کے قد جو ہے قدم جو ہے زمین میں خط کھینچ رہے ہیں عزداران حسین یہ لاش اتنا پہمال ہو چکا تھا کہ مولا نے جب لا کے خیمے کے سامنے رکھا ہے اور ماں نے جب پردہ اٹھایا سب سے پہلا سوال یہی تھا مولا یہ لاشا کس کا ہے میرے قاسم کا قد یہ نہیں تھا جو نظر آ رہا ہے عزداران حسین عاشور کے دن دو لاش پامال ہوئے تھے ایک حسین کا لاشا تھا اور ایک قاسم کا لاشا تھا لیکن ایک فرق ہے دونوں میں حسین کا لاشا پامال ہوا جب سر تن سے جدا ہو چکا تھا لیکن قاسم کی روح ابھی جسم میں تھی جب اس طرح سے پامال ہوا کہ یہ جوان کی روح ملے اعلیٰ پہ چلی جاتی
الا لعنة الله القوم الظالمين سيعلم الذين ظلموا اي منقلب ينقلبون خداوند اس قلب قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہمارے توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خداوند ہمیں توفیق دے کہ مودت و رحمت کی بنیاد پر حسین کے صدقے میں اپنی زندگی کو بسر کر سکیں خداوند جہاں جہاں مسلمان پریشان ہیں خصوصاً شیعان علی چاہے پاکستان افغانستان یا بحرین یا عراق میں ہوں ان کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ خداوند عالم اسلام میں بھی جو مصیبت آئی ہوئی ہے خصوصاً فلسطین میں جو مصائب آج کل ہو رہے ہیں خداوند ان کو بھی دشمنوں کے شر سے محفوظ رکھ امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم ماتم حسین